It will take most people some time to analyze exactly what happened at the G20 this week, but to me it seems like business as usual plus some deal. And the business as usual part is that we still have the fiat currency system, we get more regulations, but of course we know from the Security and Exchange Commission story what that means. If you have supervision, it is corruptible. We get more money pumped into the economy by the Keynesianist, the Keynesian economists. Europeans are not really on that side, and it's very good that that Europe has kind of restricted their synchronous moves with the US and the UK, because Mr. Trichet was contemplating quantitative easing earlier this week, but now he has still got the interest rate on 1.25, which is low, but it's better than nothing. So something happened, I think, and I think we find a clue in the little altercation between Mr. Sarkozy and Mr. Hu Jintao that can explain why China was not very vocal about the new reserve currency that it wanted anymore. Only Russia mentioned it. What happened was that Jintao reportedly did not want to agree or abide by a list that was created by an organization of which he's not a member. Of course, China and France are a little bit at odds, because Mr. Sarkozy went to visit the Dalai Lama, I believe, when he visited China, and China didn't like that at all. So anything French may not go that well in China at the moment, but there may be other reasons, and that may explain the intervention by Mr. Obama, who basically created a result that makes the OECD list not binding if it comes to these tax havens. And there lies possibly the reason why China is so benign, because the list that the OECD creates does not include Macau, which is a Chinese tax haven. It's 12% tax. And because it doesn't include Macau, of course it can include Macau, because it, you know, all these territories do not have to be a member of the OECD to be included in the list. It's just the OECD that determines, okay, this is an area with low taxes with non-compliance, and then it classifies them in full compliance, commitment to comply, and non-compliance. And Macau should be somewhere in those three categories, and it isn't. It's not there. And that if that is, that remains the case, and the OECD list is still kind of being looked upon as the authoritative list for countries to either agree or deny cooperation or transactions with banks in those territories, then that means that Macau will be a tax haven in the future, will remain so, and will remain a safe haven for illegal activities, monies, bribes, drug money, and etc. And all the other territories will not be able to be that, because they will all be subject to government-driven investigation if the governments choose to investigate. And that will drive a lot of money from those other tax havens to Macau, and that is a benefit for China. And just like Jim Willey had a theory that the attack on the bank secrecy in Switzerland by the US was an attempt to draw illegal monies to the tax havens of the US in the Cayman Islands, so this move can be seen as a global attempt to kind of give these currency flows or these money flows to China. And then we can theorize that in return China will, of course that's a big benefit for China, and in return China will keep cooperating with the West. Of course the IMF is also selling $6 billion of gold, and it's very likely that it sells it to China. That was also a thought by Peter Schiff, and I put a link to that thought next to this video.